Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where you are. My name is José Luis Passos. I am the director of the Center for Brazilian Studies at UCLA, where I'm also a professor of literature in the Department of Spanish and Portuguese. On behalf of Cindy Fan, Vice Provost for International Studies and Global Engagement, Chris Erickson, Senior Associate Vice Provost and Director of the International Institute, Kevin Terraciano, Director of the Latin American Institute, and Bonnie Taub, Associate Director of the Latin American Institute, I would like to welcome you to the Center for Brazilian Studies last event of the 2020 calendar year, Black Lives Matter in Brazil. The event today is part of an ongoing series on Black Lives Matter from a global perspective. You will find links to previous and upcoming events clicking on the link that I will soon share with you using the chat function of our webinar. A recording of this event and other events sponsored by the center are or will be available to you on our website. Over the past 2 years, the Center for Brazilian Studies has co-sponsored or sponsored over 60 public events in partnership with 8 different units on campus, in addition to Brazilian universities and the Consulate General of Brazil in Los Angeles. During this calendar year alone, we have featured events on COVID-19 and political authoritarianism, civil registration and human rights in Brazil, LGBTQ poetry, translation studies from an Afro-Brazilian perspective, and of course the ongoing, now 12-year-old Brazilian film series. The panel today deserves special attention. Given the need and importance of debates over racial prejudice and violence against Black population in Brazil, the event will be coordinated by my colleague, Brian Pitts, Assistant Director of the Latin American Institute, who actually put together the panel and has been a re-energizing force within the Institute, helping us to revamp our activities in the Latin American Institute and beyond. I'm also very happy to welcome today as a moderator, Professor Hugo Edu from UCLA's Department of African American Studies, a new affiliate of our Center for Brazilian Studies. I will be helping out from the backstage, managing sound and video, gathering your comments and questions. You can submit your questions in Portuguese, in Spanish or English. I will translate them if needed and send them to our panelists. Please feel free to participate and express your thoughts any way you like. This is a panel about diversity of perspectives and respect for difference, values that are an essential part of the International Institute's mission to enhance diversity, equity, and inclusion. So welcome to our panel and have a good discussion. Brian.
Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us today. And thank you, Zain, for that introduction. Ever since the events of this past summer, the death of George Floyd at the hands of the police and the mobilization that we saw all over the United States, and that was so inspiring to all of us, there have been discussions here at UCLA about really putting a spotlight on that, on this through our programming this year. And one of the things that came up immediately for all of us in our discussions was the importance of highlighting Brazil. Brazil has far and away the largest population of African descended people in the Americas and the second largest Black population in the world after Nigeria. It is a country whose levels of police violence, both against the population at large, especially the working class population, and the Black and brown population are far and away larger than, or more greater numbers than we see even here in the United States. Brazil also stands out for its very long tradition of Black mobilization against systemic racism and against state violence. And so, as we can say, Black Lives Matter in the US, Black Lives Matter in Brazil. And Brazilians have really been in the forefront of global mobilization against racism and against state violence. So with this, I'm going to go ahead and hand it over to Professor Hugo Edu, who is going to introduce our speakers. Our first speaker will be Valesca Miguel Batista, followed by Watufani Po, and followed by Alvaro Pereira do Nascimento. Professor Edu is a professor in our Department of African-American Studies. She is joined us here at UCLA just recently, and we are very pleased and very appreciative of having her with us here today. So I'll go ahead and hand it over to you, and we will go from there.
Thank you so much, and good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all of our attendees. It's my great honor to introduce our first speaker, Valesca Miguel Batista. who is a lawyer and a doctoral student in political and economic law at the Mackenzie Presbyterian University in São Paulo. She earned her MA in sustainability from the State University of Campinas. Her research focuses on questions of race, law, and citizenship, not only in Brazil, but in the US and South Africa. And she conducted research and published on issues like affirmative action, Black women in urban planning services, and structural racism in Brazil. Today, she will compare state violence against people of color in Brazil, the US, and in South Africa. Thank you so much, Alaska.
Hello. Good morning, good afternoon, good night. So thank you for opportunity to share to you about Black Lives Matter in Brazil, South Africa, United States. Thank you, Hugo Edu, for my presentation. I speak for you. I visit Nigeria. I am very happy in staying this panel for you. I am Valesca. I am 20 years old. I have black bright hair. I am a black woman. I study on the fundamentals of race in Brazil, United States, and South Africa. My advisor is Professor Silvio Almeida. I participate intergroup between University of Duke and Mackenzie about affirmative action, Brazil and United States, composed of Professor John Frantz, that's University of Duke, and students Travis Kino and Christopher Simons, and Professor Silvia Almeida, Thais Duarte, and me of Mackenzie. We studied about the arguments in favor or against affirmative action in Brazil and in United States. Is one group have studied 18 months is very interesting. So I appreciate this opportunity in share to you about Black Lives Matter because it is Black Lives Matter in Brazil, United States, South Africa, Nigeria, of the people. So I speak first about structural racism because I think this racism is one problem structure in all cultures. Okay. Professor Silvio talks in his book titled Structure Racism. Oh, sorry. Oh, okay. You understand me? Okay. Ah, okay. Sorry.
People weren't able to see your video initially, and so we were making sure that the video was fine, which it is.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Sorry for the interruption.
Okay. Professor Silvio, talking in his book title, Structural Racism, that racism is when two social dynamics, conscious or unconscious, with fundamentals in race. There are two discrimination forms, direct such as racial violence and aggression, and indirect such was one representation of Black people in works, Congress, and important position. There is institutional racism exemplified by the penal system and government policies. I will speak about policies, violence against Black people in United States, Brazil, South Africa. In three countries declared themselves formally democratic due to the power to choose their representatives. However, it is important to define that democracy requires the practice of seeking equity. No inequality or equality, but equity is more abrangent. And this has not been achieved until today. Black Lives Matter is one movement against violence and police arbitrariness in the bodies of minorities, specifically Black bodies. The movement gained a lot of attention due to the protests over the death of George Floyd. But it is important to note that is the result of the social movement of Black since the beginning of the 20th century, with the struggle of Blacks for the recognition of American citizenship, later against Jim Crow. In Brazil, since 1930, there was articulation of Black people, highlighting the Black Unified Movement in 1980 as an effective organization. Having one name is very important at this moment is Abdias Nascimento and Lélia Gonzalez. And in South Africa, Nelson Mandela struggled since 1960, having spent 27 years in prison, and with Steve Biko from 1960 to 1970 when his one mother. So we arrived in the 21st century with a history of fighting against the same violence against Blacks or non-whites. In the United States, Black people make up 30.4% of the population, but it's grouped in the main target of the policies. In Brazil, Black people represent 56% of the population, composed of brown, mixed race, or pardo, and Black people. In South Africa, Black men were 8%. But in three societies, dynamic races is very profound. In Brazil, the policies kill Black people at a rate 2.7 times higher than whites. The Atlas of Violence 2020 pointed that the murder of Black people increased by 11.5%, while that of non-Blacks decreased by 12.9%. Let's repeat here, because Brazil is very terrible for Black people. It is no who killed Marielle Franco. Every day, Black men are unjustly in prison because their race are mistaken for the faces of fugitives from public security forum albums. Who can we not think that racism in organized and organizing social relations? Only one racism can deny this truth. On 28 August 2020, Agência Brasil published that when observing the gender and races, or color cut at the same time the standardized mortality rate of black men with 250 deaths per 100,000 inhabitants, while the race for whites 157 deaths for 100,000 inhabitants, or very different situations is black and white in Brazil. Here in Brazil, we've been trying to survive under the racism, violence, and the government Bolsonaro. My professor Silvio Almeida speak, yeah, according her, it is not safe for black people to live in Brazil. It is terrible too. From about South Africa, from 1993 to 1996, South Africa read a provisional constitution, raising being established after discussion with several South African groups in the Constituent Assembly, devices that should run the country. Choose in 1996, in the indirect into force the Constitution of Republic of South Africa. In South Africa is different Brazil and United States because they have groups diverse. The preamble states that South Africa is diverse and belong to all, since to recognize past injustice, there was about the establishment of democratic values, social justice, and real human and fundamental rights. Many of the 1996 constitutional devices assert that the new South African order is founded on non-racialism and non-sexism, sealing up any kind of discrimination, not being allowed the defense of hatred that is based on race, ethnicity, gender, and religion. No one should be deprived of citizenship. Likewise, we have also identified the recognition of the ethnic and racial diversity in the country when the constitutional recognized 11 languages as their official language, includes English, Afrikaners, and 9 other ethnic languages. Brazil and South Africa main concentrated black people, majorly in the suburb ghettos in slum. At the moment, there are very segregation. Since it was not included in the legal territory of city, not being regarded was holder of the citizenship granted to whites. According to statistics, 2018, South Africa has white population, European community, mainly Dutch and English at 12%, color or mixed race at 8.5%, Asian or Chinese and Indian at 2.5%, and black included a group at 77% of the entirety of its inhabitants. In South Africa, the violence happened because they have an economic inequality, but this class is composed Black people because of the history of segregation. One important case to note is about Nathaniel, one younger man with Down syndrome and who was killed by the police. The population said it's very common. Similar Brazil. In United States of America, similar to Brazil too. It is one also found that is not safe for Blacks. The map of violence points out that the police killed Black people at a rate 3 times higher than white, and Hispanic 2 times higher than whites. The places you live in the United States is essential because according to the map of violence in Oklahoma, Blacks were 6 times more likely to be killed by the police than in Georgia, for example. It's very different. In Brazil, I studied in my master's degree as difference organization in cities, Black people and white people, is very different access in public services, for example, too. There is not accountability for the policies who commit violence against Black people, since 98.3% of police murder in the United States between 2013 and 2020 have not resulted in criminal charges. And it is noted that the biggest problem is the formation of a selective penal system with oppressed minorities reproducing the ideology of racism and xenophobia. It is also noted that speaking to the police believe they have free access to trial and punish with the death penalty. This is what we saw in the Nigerian massacre on the 20 October 2020. It is very important to mention the situation of Black women in 3 societies and the other societies, because they are faced with a lot of violence, gender, classes, and race. Angela Davis talks about the situation in her book. In Brazil, Lélia Gonzalez talks about the situation in her book too. So Black Lives Matter means all Black people are very important in America, European, Africa, but I believe that because of racism, Black people are still disposable. I think there is not for laws against racism, but I believe recognized the institutional racism and there is accountability. Accountability is very important in our societies. And racism, and white racism, can even understand words, but it cannot be sustained in tal action. Breaking with structures is not easy. It causes discomfort, but it is one place to be paid by those who recognize and understand that racism is not one problem for Black people, but for all people. I have one PowerPoint for share to you, two slides about my presentation. One moment, sorry. This is okay. This is one team in University Duke, John Franks, Silvio, Travis, me, and my colleague Thais. Have one new member, this Chris. This is structural racism in Brazil, but in his book, he is speaking one construction of racism. Is very interesting because it speaks about accountability, ideology, and racism, and classes of races is subjectivities of people. The movement Black Lives Matter is one movement very important, but is remember this is one fight other persons similar I speaking for you. Martin Luther King, Stephen Biko, Nelson Mandela, Rosa Parks, Angela Davis, Abia Dias do Nascimento, and Lélia Gonzalez. Similar because I think racism, institutional racism of Brazil. This is one tribunal in Brazil. Only white people don't have Black people in system, in penal system. This is one situation because have inequality racial in Brazil, for example. Yesterday, 100,000 Dias murder Marielle Franco, others, younger Black people. In five days, Emily, she was 4 years old, and Rebecca, 7 years old. Murder of the violence police in Brazil. Thank you so much for attention.
Thank you so much, Valeska. We're gonna move on to our next speaker, who is Watufami Poe. Sorry, just a second. Watufani Poe is a PhD candidate in Africana Studies at Brown University. He earned his BA from Swarthmore College in Africana Studies and his AM in History at Brown University, his master's at in History at Brown University. His dissertation entitled Resisting Fragmentation, The Radical Possibilities of Black LGBTQ plus Activism in Brazil and the United States, looks at Black LGBTQ plus social and political activism in both countries to understand the ways Black LGBTQ people push for freedom across various movement spaces. Thank you, Watufani.
Okay, give me one quick second while I share my screen and then we'll get started. Okay, So thank you so much to Brian and Ugo for organizing and facilitating this event today. Thank you to the UCLA Center for Brazilian Studies and to all the sponsors for funding this event, and also to all the other panelists for your wonderful presentations. I'm excited for this conversation. It's a very important topic. Today I will be talking a little bit about the types of violence that Black LGBTQ people are subjected to in Brazil, and as well as how Black movements address these violences and the needs of the Black LGBTQ people. The subject is very related to my own dissertation research, but as well, it's related to my own political passion. So I'm excited to talk to you all today about it. And I wanna give a quick trigger warning for moments of LGBTQ phobic and racist violence and death. On April 8th, 2016, during a police operation in Jardim Paiva Dois, a peripheral neighborhood of Ribeirão Preto, São Paulo, Luana Barbosa dos Reis Santos was assassinated by military police officers. Santos was a Black mother and lesbian who dressed in a masculine gender presentation, and she was stopped with her son by a group of male military police officers looking suspicious. The police violently forced her to open her legs to be frisked by cops. Santos demanded her right by law to be frisked by a female police officer, but instead of granting her request, the police officers violently beat her for denying to be frisked. She died 5 days later from the aggression she suffered at the hands of police officers. In response to Santos's death, Black women activists in São Paulo led a protest down Paulista Avenue and throughout downtown São Paulo. The protesters rose their voices in anger at this act of anti-Black lesbophobic violence. On July 2nd, 2016, Diego Vieira Machado, a Black gay working class student at the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro, was found dead in Guanabara Bay, killed in an apparent hate crime. Friends from the university commented on how Machado, a student activist, was regularly the target of homophobic and racist violence. Black LGBTQ activists in Rio and throughout Brazil shared pictures of Machado in mourning with the hashtag Respeita as Bichas Pretas. Bichas Pretas being the language commonly used within Black LGBTQ communities to refer to one another. On May 6th, 2018, after being missing for a week, Mateusa Passarelli, a Black non-binary student at the State University of Rio de Janeiro, an artist, was found dead. Passarelli had gone missing after a party on the evening of April 29th and was violently murdered by a drug trafficking faction in the Morro dos 18 in the northern zone of Rio de Janeiro. The week that Passarelli was missing, friends and Black LGBTQ community throughout Rio led a campaign to find them, fearing racist and LGBTQ phobic violence had claimed Passarelli's life. Marielle Franco was a city councilwoman in Rio de Janeiro elected in 2016, who won the fifth most votes out of all 55 city council people in the city that year. On March 14th, 2018, she was assassinated on her way home. Franco, a Black bisexual mother from the favela of Maré, was on her way home from an event at the Casa das Pretas to encourage Black women to enter political fields and other leadership roles to help change the systems of power and barriers that oppress Black women. Franco, during her tenure as a city councilwoman, fought boldly for the rights of women, Black people, favelados, and the LGBTQ community. She even stood up against the 2008 Rio military intervention in the city council, because she knew the victims of the intervention would in large part be poor, Black, and favelados. Massive protests rippled throughout Brazil in response to Franco's death, and what many saw as an attempt at a political silencing of a Black bisexual woman who spoke out for Black, feminist, LGBTQ, and poor communities. Calls of Marielle Presente and King mandó matar Marielle Franco, who ordered the killing of Marielle Franco, rang out as people demanded to know who killed Franco. Who ordered Franco's assassination is still under investigation. But many believe that Brazil's current neo-fascist right-wing president, Jair Bolsonaro, played a role in her assassination. So I cite these four different deaths killed by different kinds of people, police, neo-fascists, drug traffickers, and militias, because when we talk about Black Lives Matter, besides police violence, we also have to talk about state-sanctioned violence, especially in the case of Black LGBTQ people, because the forms of violence that Black LGBTQ people pass through and institutions that attack them are varied. However, just because their harassers and killers are not wearing police uniform does not mean that this violence is not state sanctioned or sanctioned by the systems of power that work to eliminate Black people. Finding statistics on the violence that the Black LGBTQ population faces in Brazil is difficult due to the under-notification of crimes against LGBTQ populations and the inadequate data on race and color of those who do register violences against them. As studies done by both Fundação Oswaldo Cruz and Grupo Gay da Bahia note, when their statistics don't disproportionately find high numbers of violence toward Black LGBTQ populations, that the data on these violences is most likely underreported. Grupo Gay da Bahia argues that the stark difference between the extremely high disproportionate rate of death rate of Black populations in Brazil do not match up with the reported rate of Black LGBTQ deaths. So these two charts that I have on this slide, on one side is it's showing the death rate, the homicide rate of Black populations, and whereas with it's 29% with white populations, it's 71%, this is in 2017, with Black populations. And in 2018, I believe it was 76%. So it's very disproportionate, the amounts of homicidal violence that Black people face. But in the data that we have of LGBTQ violence, white people are represented in the majority. But Grupo Gay da Bahia points out that that's probably because of the underreporting that LGBTQ violence. And many reasons could account for this, including the number of LGBTQ populations that keep their sexuality or gender secret, or the family members that do after their deaths. However, amongst the violent LGBTQ deaths reported, Black trans women are the group that reports the highest violence death rate out of all LGBTQ groups. So while the lack of good statistics makes it difficult to understand completely the scope of violence the Black LGBTQ community faces from an empirical standpoint, it's important to note that these difficulties are not new for the study of Black populations in Brazil. In Abdias do Nascimento's 1978 book on the genocide of Black populations in Brazil, he argues that statistics of Black populations have historically worked to erase and actively genocide Black communities in Brazil. The disappearance of Black populations into other color classifications in Brazilian statistics, Nascimento argues, works to erase Black people from the violences they face and from the historiography of Brazil. While the Brazilian Academy has come a long way in confronting anti-Blackness, analyzing the lack of data on violence against Black LGBTQ populations shows that the ways that his argument still holds up. However, continuing the long tradition of Black communities speaking from their own experience about the violences they face, even when the statistics are not available to support it, Black LGBTQ people continue to speak out against the intersectional violences they face as a part of this project of Black genocide in Brazil. A coalition of Black movement organizations in Brazil founded in 2019 called the Coalition of Black Movements, in their opening statement, acknowledges the fact that when the movement against Black genocide of Black people is invoked, it is speaking to the intersections of various systems of power that play a part in Black people's lives. A quote from their opening statement reads, and this is a translation, "Brazil sees itself in front of a mirror that shows its maladies. The only counterpoint of hope possible in this white, old, rich, heterosexual, and cisgender face that occupies the top of the social pyramid and the majority in spaces of power is in the transformative potential of women, men, youth, and LGBTQIA people, favelados, and people from the periphery, people from quilombos, imprisoned people, and homeless people, Black people who form the majority of the Brazilian population. So this kind of intersectional approach, intersectional reading that the coalition of Black movements is taking on was not always the case for Black movements within Brazil. My research on Black LGBTQ activism touches on one of the first Black gay groups formed in Brazil, Ade Dudu, which was founded within the Movimento Negro Unificado, the Unified Black Movement in Salvador, Bahia in 1980. One of the co-founders of the group, Wilson Mandela, who's right in the center of this slide, explained to me that in the beginning, it was difficult to bring to the table the struggles of Black gay men at the time, because of numerous reasons. The Black movement's fear of the taboos relating to being gay, lesbian, of being related to gay, lesbian, and trans groups, the idea that gayness was a white thing, and the prevalence of homophobia and transphobia within the Black community. Another one of my interviewees pictured here, Neuza Das Dores Pereira, a leader within the Black women's movement, echoed these difficulties within the Black movement and the Black women's movement. Pereira insisted that many Black lesbian women chose or were forced into silence because of the lack of comfortability of the larger Black and Black women's movement to face questions of non-heteronormative sexuality. Despite Black lesbian and bisexual women being at the leadership of many Black women's organizations. The Coalition of Black Movements statement shows the long way that Black movements in Brazil have come to addressing the intersecting violences that Black people face, including Black LGBTQ people. Part of this is due to the permanence of people like Mandela and Pereira within Black movements to push them to expand their ideologies. The other part is due to the visibility of Black LGBTQ figures in a politicized way. Erika Malunguinho, pictured here in the slide, is a Black trans artist and activist from São Paulo who founded Aparelho Luzia in 2016. Aparelho Luzia is a Black multi-purpose organizing space, performance space, and restaurant, effectively called by the community a quilombo urbano, or an urban maroon community. Malunguinho was elected as a state representative in 2018 in São Paulo, and the first trans person in Brazil to serve as a state representative in a solo campaign. But Erika Malunguinho has always been critical of these firsts. Posted to Malunguinho's Instagram account in 2020, this picture here, quotes her saying, in 2018, they asked me insistently, what is it like being the first trans representative elected in Brazil? I responded, ready, it's a denouncement. So here, Malunguinho is clearly criticizing the celebration of her being the first Black trans woman within as a state representative, because the problem there is that where were Black trans people all those years before 2018 when she was elected? So Erika Malunguinho echoes this statement in 2018 at Harvard's Afro-Descendants in Brazil conference that invited many well-known Black activists in Brazil and scholars of Blackness in Brazil to speak on the situation of Afro-Descendants in Brazil. Malunguinho, an invited speaker, began her talk pointing out that she was the only trans person invited to speak at the conference. She urged everyone to think about if trans people aren't invited to participate in actions, conferences, and movements of Black people, how they are relegated to spaces such as sex work, where they are used by rich white men, but kept out of sight and subjected to various violences. Erika Hilton, another Black trans woman from São Paulo, who in 2020 just recently was elected as a city council person with nearly 50,000 votes and the sixth most voted city council person within the city, echoes Malunguinho's highlighting of the ways in which Black trans women are sidelined and left without a space within society and movements. Hilton reflecting on the time in her life where she was expelled from home for being trans and turned to sex work and to survive, she says, I quote, "When I saw myself in the place of prostitution and homelessness, of dehumanization, of being a non-citizen, when I saw that my body was seen as a thing to be violated, bought, massacred, humiliated, I began to see that there was something wrong. But in that moment, still very young, I had no reference within activism. I had no references within activism." So the visibility and work of people like Hilton, Malunguinho, Pereira, and Mandela have worked to expand the conceptualization of the varied forms of violence as Black people face. Black LGBTQ people's work in and outside of Black movements in Brazil, Black LGBTQ people's work within and outside of Black movements in Brazil has worked to shift conversations about who should be centered in conversations of Black lives mattering, and have shown the ways in which heteropatriarchal violences work in tandem with white supremacy and capitalism. These bold statements against intersectional violence in Brazil work to advance a project of Black freedom for all Black people in Brazil. And I want to end with a short clip that shows the continued work, work towards this freedom for all Black people by the Black Femme Bahian Collective Afrobafo.
No movimento LGBT ainda há muita resistência em discutir raça, em discutir sobre racismo, e os nossos corpos negros são muito hipersexualizados e colocados sempre só na questão do desejo, não da afetividade. No movimento negro também é muito difícil, porque para eles era apenas mais uma outra coisa casada com o que é ser negro, porque o racismo teria um peso maior.
Estranha a preta da favela, quando ela tá passando, todos rindo a cara dela. Mas...
Então, a Afrobafo foi iniciada justamente para discutir questões de intersecção de raça, sexualidade e gênero, que a gente vive no país onde o racismo institucional impera. E vivemos no país que mais mata LGBT no mundo. Então, a Afrobafo começou justamente com essa estratégia de discutir as nossas questões através de narrativas e ferramentas mais inovadoras, digamos assim. E a gente pensou também em ir justamente para os lugares que também não têm esse acesso virtual. E a gente ia para as ruas, para pontes da cidade de Salvador, fazer intervenções em espaços que geralmente não nos querem, né, na verdade. A gente quer também ter, ocupar esses espaços que também são nossos, para que as pessoas entendam que nós somos tão humanos quanto elas. A gente usa a arte para fazer um diálogo sobre o que nós somos e o que nós queremos.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Watifani. And we move on to our last panelist, which is Álvaro Pereira do Nascimento. Álvaro Pereira do Nascimento is a professor of history at the Federal Rural University of Rio de Janeiro, a university that serves the students from the Baixada Fluminense, the working class suburbs located to the northwest of the city of Rio de Janeiro. Dr. Nascimento holds a PhD in history from the State University of Campinas, and is a former Rockefeller Humanities Fellow at Northwestern University. His dissertation and eventual first book, Citizenship, Color, and Discipline in the Navy Revolt of 1910, was a 2003 winner of the prize in Race Relations and Black Culture in Brazil, given by the Centro de Estudos Brasileiros and the Ford Foundation. He will speak with us today about the genocide Afro-Brazilians face as a result of both violence committed by the state and violence the state could prevent but fails to. Thank you so much, Álvaro.
Good morning, good afternoon, good night, good evening. Thank you a lot for inviting me to this important, terrific event. Just a minute, sorry, I have a kid. Sorry. Well, thank you a lot for inviting me, Brian and Luis, for this terrific event about Black Lives Matter. For me, it's a great pleasure to stay here, sharing this event with you, Watofani, José Luis, Hugo, Valesca. And I will present my speech in Portuguese. That's why I apologize for you guys. And very thanks to and Brian, thank you a lot for translate my speech, okay? Well, okay. O Estado brasileiro contribuiu diariamente para o genocídio da população negra, inculcando em gerações o mito da democracia racial através de uma política negacionista da existência do racismo no Brasil. A última grande onda de inculcação foi durante a ditadura militar, com alterações diretas dos conteúdos aprendidos nas escolas. Esta situação começa a ser partida nos anos do século XXI, com as pressões internacionais trazidas pelos acordos diplomáticos para a erradicação do racismo e da xenofobia propostas pela ONU, assim como a pressão do movimento organizado que criou e assumiu departamentos governamentais durante a gestão do Partido dos Trabalhadores.
The Brazilian state has contributed directly to the genocide of Brazil's black population by promoting over the course of generations the myth of racial democracy through policies that had denied the existence of racism in Brazil. The last great wave of this promotion of racial democracy was during Brazil's 1964 to 1985 military dictatorship. And this was something that was actually actively reproduced in Brazil's schools. This situation has begun to be combated over the course of the first years of the 21st century with international pressure brought in by diplomatic agreements that Brazil has signed, treaties that Brazil has signed to for the eradication of racism and xenophobia promoted by the United Nations. And as a result of the pressure of the organized black movement, which has acted to promote black interests through the governments of, particularly the Workers' Party and former President Lula.
Okay. Thank you. Inicio esta comunicação pela ressaca eleitoral da virada conservadora que venceu as eleições de 2018. Depois, apresento dados dos recentes assassinatos ou do genocídio da população negra e termino com a mobilização do movimento negro para o enfrentamento aos atuais governos.
So this talk will start on a somber note with the discussion of the recent electoral setbacks that progressive forces in Brazil have faced and the turn towards the right, which won the election in 2018 with the election of Jair Bolsonaro as president. Then I'll move on to discussing data about recent murders of people of color in Brazil, and I will end with mobilization of the black movement to face the conservative policies of the current governments, federal and state governments.
Okay. A eleição do presidente Jair Bolsonaro e de alguns governadores de estado permitiu a retomada de uma política de endurecimento das leis e encarceramento em massa, que atinge, sobretudo, jovens negros e indivíduos com baixa escolaridade. No Brasil, são os governadores de estados que são responsáveis pelas polícias. Bolsonaro foi eleito simulando uma pistola com a mão direita. O governador do estado do Rio de Janeiro, Wilson Witzel, foi eleito por um eleitorado cansado da violência urbana. Esses eleitores desejaram uma política de segurança pública mais dura. Brian?
The election of President Jair Bolsonaro and several right-wing state governors has facilitated the return of policies of hardline policies as far as laws and the promotion of mass incarceration, which have which above all have affected young people, black people, and people with low levels of schooling. It's important to keep in mind that in Brazil, state governors are the ones who are responsible for the police forces. Bolsonaro was infamously elected, appearing at his campaign rallies, making a gun with his hand like this to show the policy that he would take against crime and against bandidos, as he put them. And also the state governor of Rio de Janeiro, also elected in 2018, Wilson Witzel, was elected by voters who were tired of urban violence and high levels of crime. These voters have desired a more hardline policies of public security. In fact, it's even common to hear people in Brazil asking that the death penalty be restored. Death penalty has been illegal throughout most of Brazil's history, except for a brief time during the military dictatorship, where it was never applied.
Witzel prometeu tiro na cabeça de traficantes em favelas, através de snipers da polícia. Em uma oportunidade, como a Tufani mostrou, quebrou uma placa de rua com o nome da vereadora negra Marielle Franco. Witzel e Bolsonaro apoiaram-se mutuamente na campanha eleitoral. Foi assim que os milhões de eleitores de Bolsonaro também elegeram Witzel, que era um desconhecido até então pelos habitantes do Rio de Janeiro. Após vencerem as disputas eleitorais, retomaram políticas de segurança pública questionadas e abandonadas anteriormente. Nos primeiros anos de seus governos, as mortes aumentaram tanto que a Suprema Corte brasileira proibiu operações policiais em comunidades pobres durante a pandemia do COVID-19. Brian?
So, Witzel proposed that the best course of action to take against drug traffickers would be a shot in the head in favelas via police snipers. At one time, he broke a street sign that had been put up to commemorate Marielle Franco during the 2018 campaign. Who, as we heard in the previous presentation, had been assassinated in an ambush organized by former military policemen. Witzel and Bolsonaro have mutually supported each other throughout the electoral campaign in 2018. And this was how the millions of voters for Bolsonaro in Rio also voted for Wilson Witzel as governor of the state, someone who previously had been almost completely unknown in Rio politics. After winning their respective electoral campaigns, they have readopted policies of public security that had already during past governments been questioned and rejected. In the first years of their governments, the deaths at the hands of the police grew so much that the Brazilian Supreme Court prohibited police operations in working class communities during the COVID-19 pandemic.
Thank you. No Rio de Janeiro, 10.814 pessoas mortas em ações da polícia, mortas pela polícia em 2019, 1.423 delas, ou seja, 78,5%, foram pretas ou pardas. 43% destas tinham entre 14 e 30 anos de idade, né? E segundo o IBGE, um instituto brasileiro de estatística, 54% da população do Rio de Janeiro se declara preta ou parda. Em 2017, cidades do estado da Bahia, São Paulo, Rio de Janeiro, Ceará, Minas Gerais, Pernambuco e Pará apresentaram números com grande quantidade de mortos. O estado da Bahia foi o que mais teve jovens negros assassinados. 6.377 jovens só na Bahia. Uma média de 17 assassinados por dia no ano de 2017. Um a cada 82 minutos. No Rio de Janeiro, esse número chegou a 12 por dia, um a cada 2 horas. É importante destacar que, em 2017, Bolsonaro e Witzel ainda não tinham se candidatado aos cargos de presidente e governador do Rio de Janeiro. Ou seja, os governos anteriores também não haviam feito o suficiente para proteger vidas negras. Brian?
So in Rio de Janeiro, of the 1,814 people killed by police in 2019, 1,423 of those, or nearly 79%, were classified as either black or brown. 43% of those killed were between the ages of 14 and 30. According to the Brazilian Census Bureau, which is responsible for researching and analyzing social and economic data, 54% of the population of Rio de Janeiro declares itself to be black or brown. This exists in a wider context of urban violence in Brazil, not only at the hands of the police, but just in general. In 2017, cities in Bahia, São Paulo, Rio de Janeiro, Ceará, Minas Gerais, Pernambuco, Pará, various states had a very large number of people who were murdered. The state of Bahia, with 6,377 murders, was one of the worst of these. And it was the one that, where the most young people of color were killed. Bahia had had an average of 17 murders per day in 2017, one every 82 minutes. In Rio, this number arrived to be 12 was 12 per day, one every 2 hours. It's important to point out that in 2017, Bolsonaro and Witzel had not been elected yet. Or in other words, previous governments had also not taken measures to reduce urban violence, which disproportionately affects people of color.
As determinações governamentais para diminuir estas mortes são descentralizadas e recebem insuficientes recursos financeiros. Daí vem uma pergunta: como os movimentos organizados estão resistindo a este aumento da violência contra a população negra? Repetindo, como os movimentos organizados estão resistindo a este aumento da violência contra a população negra? Brian?
Acho que a gente saiu um pouquinho do nível, né? Então agora a gente pulou para outra página ou como foi que a gente veio?
Rapaz, estou botando aqui no texto, no nosso chat.
So the government measures to reduce these deaths have been decentralized and have received insufficient financial resources. Pode repetir o que falou sobre... there we go, I got it. Mm-hmm. And then also in the last 20 years, the internet has exponentially amplified access to, has especially increased access to various source information and has allowed instant contact over social media. Videos and photos can have explosive results, as we've seen here in the United States as well. So Brazilian social movements, organized movements or more spontaneous movements, have always occupied the streets and public plazas. They have to protest. You know, they have looted stores, have burned public transportation. This has a long history of popular mobilization in Brazil of this type. These are actions by citizens that denounce the absence of the government in the guarantee of rights to the people who live in the peripheral regions, peripheral working class regions of the major cities.
Okay. Logo abaixo, as reportagens televisivas procuram não captar e reproduzir as falas dos protestantes. As falas dos protestantes, apagando e desvirtuando a ação destas pessoas. Contudo, a situação vem mudando nos últimos 20 anos. A grande mídia percebeu que suas reportagens vão ao ar após milhões de downloads e trocas de mensagens no WhatsApp, Instagram, Twitter e Facebook.
So the TV reporting about these protests has really been very limited. In fact, there's been a concerted effort to not reproduce the messages from these protesters. thus erasing and diminishing and seeking to diminish the impact of these sorts of popular actions. However, the situation has been changing over the last 20 years. Debates have become more frequent among social media, and even Brazil's large media has realized that their when they report, the things that they report are things that have already been shared millions of times via downloads and exchanges of messages on WhatsApp, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and so on.
Okay. Até recentemente, como alertou a professora Luciana Brito, o mito da democracia racial gerou uma cegueira na população brasileira, principalmente branca, que nos faz naturalizar mortes como a de João Alberto, que morreu em Porto Alegre a pancadas.
So until recently, as Professor Luciana Brito tells us, the myth of racial democracy generated a blindness among the Brazilian population, particularly the Brazilian white population, which made them naturalize deaths like that of João Alberto, a young black man who was killed and who was beaten to death in Porto Alegre.
Yeah. Eu vou acelerar um pouco por causa do tempo, tá? Eu vou passar aqui para uma outra parte.
We're going to skip ahead as a result of time constraints to a different part of the presentation.
Yeah. Entre 1964 e 85, o golpe da civil militar levou 5 generais à presidência, tá? E eles esses militares conservadores investiram na educação escolar, com disciplinas que referendavam o mito da união das três raças, branco, negro e indígena. Tá? As disciplinas de história e geografia foram transformadas em outra, sem nenhum questionamento acerca de posicionamentos políticos ou raciais.
Between 1964 and 1985, the military and civilian coup brought 5 generals to the presidency of Brazil. These conservative generals and officers invested in education through mandatory civics courses that endorsed the idea of that Brazil is a union of 3 races: black, white, black, and indigenous. They claimed that in Brazil there was harmony between these people who lived under this sort of gushingly patriotic racial democracy. Areas like history and geography were transformed in social studies without any real questioning of the political positions that were being taken through the way the military was attempting to reform the curriculum.
Minha hipótese está aí. Pelo menos 4 gerações de professores tiveram formação sob a vigilância e controle dos militares das universidades que formavam professores. Essas gerações de docentes ensinaram história e reproduziam a democracia racial e o mito das 3 raças até pelo menos a década de 2000, após 20 ou 30 anos de sala de aula. Certamente, muitos deles aprenderam a criticar este mito após o fim da ditadura, mas não sabemos quantos nem quando fizeram.
So at least four generations of Brazilian university professors were trained under the military dictatorship and its curriculum in schools. University's autonomy was suspended, was eliminated, and was subordinated to to the dictates of the military dictatorship. These generations of professors have taught history and reproduced racial democracy and the myth of the 3 races, at least through the early 2000s, after 20 or 30 years teaching. Certainly many of them have learned to criticize this myth of racial democracy since the end of the military dictatorship, but we don't know how many of those are or when they've done so. And so this racial democracy continues to have very important influence in the Brazilian educational system.
Mm-hmm. O combate ao racismo tomou outro caminho O combate ao racismo tomou outro caminho na virada do século XX para o XXI, ainda no governo de Fernando Henrique Cardoso. A pressão do movimento negro organizado, através de protestos em Brasília, e a apresentação de propostas para erradicação do racismo, levaram o presidente a criar grupos de trabalho interministerial e apoiar outras ações, como a criação de um comitê nacional com a participação de políticos, ativistas e acadêmicos negros, na terceira Conferência Mundial contra o Racismo, Discriminação Racial, Xenofobia e Intolerâncias Correlatas, realizadas nos anos 2001 em Durban, África do Sul.
It was at the end of the 20th century, beginning of the 21st, during the government of Fernando Henrique Cardoso, that things began to change in Brazil towards an increased consciousness of racism. On the pressure of the organized black movement through protest in Brasilia and the presentation of proposals to eradicate racism led the president to create interministerial working groups and to support other types of other policies, like the creation of a national committee with the participation of politicians, activists, and black academics. At the Third World Conference Against Racism, Discrimination, Racial Discrimination, Xenophobia, and Related Intolerance, a global conference that happened in September of 2001 in Durban, South Africa.
Okay. Com o retorno de governos conservadores de Jair Bolsonaro e governadores de estados, as mudanças trazidas com as políticas afirmativas estão se mostrando sólidas. O diálogo entre ativistas negros do Brasil e dos Estados Unidos é antigo, mas ele vem crescendo a cada ano. Existe uma quantidade cada vez maior de estudantes negros nas universidades públicas brasileiras que discute o racismo e vem atraindo maior quantidade de pessoas brancas para o debate. Essas gerações estão observando os movimentos de luta antirracista nos Estados Unidos e convidando ativistas negras a participarem de palestras, oficinas, visitas, e estão em constante diálogo. Exemplo disso é... são as visitas de Angela Davis, né, e o Paul Tomeri, né, em 2019, aqui no Brasil. Né, essas, tanto Angela Davis como o Paul Tomeri estiveram aqui para discutir o assunto.
So, with the return of conservative government since 2018, on the changes that have been brought by the last 20 years of more progressive racial policies have turned out to be strong enough to survive even amidst this right-wing government. We don't have precise studies about how many organizations there are, but black associations continue to grow in universities, favelas, among left political parties, and on the urban peripheries. They've been responsible for a real shift in the way Brazilians talk about race, with a rejection of the term prejudice and a focus on the term racism, which is something that is not popular in the parlance of Brazilian racial democracy. In addition, the dialogue between black activists in Brazil and the U.S. is something that has been around for a long time, but it's something that's been growing even more recently. There is an ever-growing number of black students in Brazilian public universities who have discussed racism and have been attracting a larger number of white people to the debate by putting this on the agenda within universities. These generations have been observing the social movements against racism in the United States and have been inviting black activists from the US to participate in lectures, visits, and as a result are in constant dialogue with the black movement in the US. Angela Davis has been to Brazil many times, to cities like Rio de Janeiro, São Paulo, and Salvador. Who is the other person you cited? Que também?
Paul Tomeri.
Yes, in addition. And so thousands of people, especially women, have gone to hear Black American speakers who have come to Brazil. Their books have been translated and read by Black women who seek to dialogue with Angela Davis's thought, for example, things like colonialism, machismo, capitalism, and racism are concepts that have become and really have become a big part of the conversation in Brazil as well. And also, of course, Opal Tometi being the other activist who has come to Brazil several times to participate in dialogue with the Black movement.
Encerro a minha fala com o depoimento de Vanessa Francisco Salles, que está na tela, mãe da menina Agatha, morta no interior de uma van numa comunidade do Rio de Janeiro pelas mãos da polícia. Ela demonstra o quadro que vem se alterando na proposta de uma consciência negra em todas as áreas, principalmente nas periféricas. Ela disse, numa entrevista, ela afirmou: "Eu confesso que relutei um tempo de correr, ou seja, de participar com as pessoas negras, mas hoje está tão escrachado isso, é o sentimento de que eu mato negro sim, é o negro que passa segurança, é o negro que não pode crescer, é o negro que não consegue. Eu relutei contra isso, mas esse momento está me abrindo a visão disso. Ainda tem preconceito sim da parte da sociedade quanto ao negro. Mal sabem eles que o negro pode fazer muito mais."
I will close with the testimony of Vanessa Francisco Salles, mother of the girl Agatha, who was killed in the interior, in the back of a van in a community of Rio by the police. Mm-hmm. Her testimony demonstrates how much things have been changing as far as proposing publicly Black consciousness in all areas, but primarily in the peripheries of the major cities. Vanessa said, "I confess that I for a long time I was reluctant to really make myself a part of the Black movement, to consider myself Black. But this is just ridiculous today. It's this feeling so many people have of, yeah, I can kill Black people, but it's Black people who live this daily insecurity as a result. And as a result, there's this idea that Black people are not able to grow, that Black people can't accomplish anything. I was reluctant to really make myself part of this movement. But this moment is opening my vision to everything going on in our country. Yes, there certainly is prejudice against Black people, against a part of our society, against Black people. They don't know how much we're capable of. Thank you."
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you so much to our wonderful speakers. Sorry, I have to put my earphones back in. I'll try to keep my comments really, really short and really brief, just to think of some things that the panelists helped us or highlighted in the discussions, right? So the way that racism and institutional racism continue to structure our social relations, right? And producing these societies that essentially cannot and refuse to cultivate and nurture Black life, right? They also spoke to, I think, the importance of an intersectional approach to addressing anti-Black racism that manifests in the case of policing, but also state-sanctioned violence. We can think about healthcare, we can think about domestic work, and so many other ways in which anti-Black racism manifests in Brazil, in the US, in South Africa. And just again to remind us that Black Lives Matter was created to affirm and to attend to all Black lives, right? So at all the intersections that we can think of, that was the intention behind Black Lives Matter. So in practice, how do we continue to uphold that? And just again, highlighting the way that criminality, disposability, and violence easily map onto Black bodies and Black ways of life, of making life. And then that's used to justify this violence against the Black population. And then we also just pointing out the way racism or the refusal to recognize racism and the way that people are differently inserted into these social hierarchies has real implications for life trajectories, specifically for the Black population. So I'll leave it at that and ask a question, and then for the panelists, and then from there I'll go to questions that came from the audience. One question I might ask is, how might we take Malugiu's, I think it was, right, Latifani, this idea of it's a denouncement. How might Black Lives Matter, if you think of it as a denouncement, how might that differently mobilize how we work to deconstruct these anti-Black structures in Brazil, you can think of in the US, South Africa?
I can jump in. So just quickly, I think that if we think through the ways in which ideas around racial violence are being addressed now, not as an advancement forward, but what we should have been doing for all these years since the beginning of these countries. So if we think of racial affirmative actions in the university, not as the savior, but actually not enough, not going far enough. If we change our frame of thinking to understanding that the fact that Black people are finding social mobility, the fact that Black people are speaking out against racism, the fact that Black people are kind of changing their own stories with help from leftist policies within the government, with affirmative action, with all these things. If we understand that as what should happen, what should have always happened, then that will, I think, give us tools to actually give us the tools we need to actually make a free society, to the tools we need to make a society in which Black people can be free. So if we're not looking at Black people being elected as this great advancement forward, but actually a denouncement of the society we live in, we can then make kind of transformative ideas about the societies and the kind of governments we want.
Yes, so I according to what the funny point, because the situations Black people in three societies, Brazil, United States, South Africa, but I included, I study about Nigeria, is very situation because the only structure have, I understand Black people, don't have interest of government because the policies only for fundamentals of race in Brazil, United States, or fundamentals of class, or fundamentals of capitalism because the other other motivations for violence, but all violence is means exploration of people, and I think have other situation have intersectionality situation of Black woman in Brazil, in United States, in Nigeria, but is situation of movement, feminist movement, different, have other fundamentals, but I think is a violence, oppression, aggression is very similar. I don't understand us change the situation of don't understand or I understand it's very necessary recognize the structure, the necessary other govern, other organization, the society is very radical of application to the law, repudium of racism, of violence of group LGBTQIA+, KEA mais, sorry, in English, I don't know. But in Portuguese, it's LGBTQIA+. in Black Woman and Class Poor, but and I think it's necessary to understand white poor is different, black poor is different, woman, black woman is different, white woman is different, woman, black woman, other ethnics in South Africa, because I have 11 languages in Nigeria, other cultures in United States, other reality is, but all black people is very important. Thank you.
Álvaro, you're muted.
Thank you, Hugo. I think I can put together your question and the another question here. I understand we don't have just one answer to face the Black genocide in Brazil. It's so difficult, but I believe there is a hope in the new generations who was born around the 1990 or 2000, because they was born in on the new governments, and there is a revolution on the books to the schools. It's so nice with the new approach about the history of Brazil, and the face and against to racial democracy. It's a big problem in Brazil. And the new generations, the black new generations are so solid, are so strong, and they are changing parties, political parties, black movements too, a white movement too, and it's so important to put maybe a first Brazilian black Brazilian black president to Brazil, or governor, and the purest ending councils. But you know, Marielle Franco was murdered by former police, and that's I think it's the big problem to face to eradicate the genocide in Brazil.
Thank you. We have two questions from the audience. So I think I'll read both of them and then let you all answer. So one question is, due to so much injustice, how do the minorities express the imposter syndrome? Do educational institutions promote equity there? And I think there means US. And if so, how? Which universities and programs foster people's development and equity for more professional opportunities for all? So that's one set of questions. And then a second set of questions, as the panelists have mentioned, social media, including WhatsApp, have aided protest movements, amplified the voices of marginalized communities, and disseminated awareness of racial violence by state agents. At the same time, these medias have informed Brazil's sharp turn to the right, including the Bolsonaro and Witzel campaigns. How do you evaluate the impact of these technologies on the pursuit of racial justice in Brazil? How can social justice movements take better advantage of social media? We can think about, I mean, Nigeria is not part of this, but Walaska, the way that social media was super important for the NSARS movement that happened recently against police brutality there, right?
Yeah. the question is very interesting because the media in Brazil is very complicated because it is a heavy formation is conservador in Brazil. the media reproducing this ideology about racism, about inequalities, because it don't have, or I think have in less proportion in Black people in the media, in the positions of including the journals, the government, and this is important because they don't have or vision Black people in the reproducing the media. So the media in Brazil reproducing the ideologies show Black people is criminals, is Black people don't like work, don't like studies. This is very normal in novels and movies and journals. And I think this is help construction, this is imagining of Black people in the world. Because if the media shows Black people in the universe, in the government, I think is imagination of Black people is very different, because it have very natural, very normal, very common, don't have Black people in media, only Black people in penal system, only Black people in prison, only Black people in the situation despair. I think this is reproducing, this is reflex of racism in Brazil, this is reflex of racism in the racism specific in Brazil, because I think situation in United States is little different, because your change movies or series only have Black people. In Brazil, don't have Black people this position. Thank you.
So quick, I think that when we're thinking about social media, it's super important, but especially I think what I've seen in the kind of diasporic conversations that are happening. So between Brazil and South Africa, Brazil and the USA, Brazil and Nigeria, I think the kind of conversations between Black communities and the diaspora, social media has been super important for that, because the kind of narrative that you'll get, like Valesca was saying, the kind of narrative that you'll get about Black movements, whether in Brazil or abroad, will be very different from coming from, you know, the mouth or the keyboard of whoever it is who's in the movement, who is actively participating. And, you know, I think that was especially clear as someone who is from the United States looking at what was going on in Brazil after the death of the man who was killed in Carrefour in Porto Alegre, because the ways in which the Brazilian media represents those movements are very different from the ways in which they're gonna show, you know, the protests against George Floyd. And there's, you know, they were talking about vandalism and people burning down stores in Brazil. But, you know, when that happens in the United States, it's not necessarily put in a positive light, but it is put in a way that this is a constructive thing that needs to happen to better what's going on. And that's not the spin that it puts on what's going on in Brazil. So those kinds of diasporic conversations are important when Black Brazilian activists are able to speak for themselves and put that out there on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, all these spaces. So it's super important in terms of solving the problem, because it's also a space that has a lot of false information. In terms of solving that, I don't know. I think that the corporations need to step up to do something about that, but you know, capitalism, so they're not going to. And so I think that what that means is that it's not just about being on social media, but it's also about the kind of community education that we're receiving in person. How are we both sharing what's going on, but also being in community with one another to talk through the thing that we're seeing on social media, to talk through what's right and what's wrong, what's true and what's false. And so I think that social media cannot just be social media when it comes to social movements, that it has to be in tandem with kind of community conversations. Those are my two cents.
Well, Brian, I need you. But I have to say, social media works to God and to devil. It's not a problem to social media, okay? And I understand we don't have we are not strong to face the capitalism or the colonialism, but we need to create a group or different kind of groups to face together the capitalism or the racism first. First of all, we need to face the racism. We don't have a just one way to finish this, but we need to save our lives of our son, my son. Everyone see him here, and that's why that's a problem to me. That's my expectation, and I understand the social media is a way, but. But how can I say it? Social media is a big problem. It's like a bomb who will explode, which will explode in future. But we needed to take this opportunity to put Black people together around in Brazil and around of the world and the Africa diaspora, because together we are more strong. And racism is so strong, but we will be more than racism. That's I believe. Thank you.
And with that, I believe our time is about up, or perhaps slightly past up. I want to thank everyone for joining us today and watching. I would like to thank our panelists for joining us from Rio de Janeiro, São Paulo, and Providence, and our moderator for joining us from Nigeria. So this has been not only a transnational, but a transcontinental talk today. I would also like to acknowledge and express our appreciation for the support, not only the Latin American Institute and the Center for Brazilian Studies, but also the Department of History, the Department of Spanish and Portuguese, the Department of Public Policy, the International Human Rights Program at the UCLA School of Law, and the Department of Geography for their generous support for this event. You can always follow Latin American Institute and the Center for Brazilian Studies on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube to see our upcoming events. Once again, thank you so much to all of our panelists, and until next time.
Thank you.